Hello everyone, it is Joe here from OmniPoke, the channel that brings you guys everything Pokemon. Today we're looking at Blacephalon. It ended up getting two top 36 placements in the International Championships in Melbourne, and that really surprised me. So I thought I would give it another whirl and see how viable Blacephalon is in the new meta. One thing I have added is the one Alolan Grimer, one Alolan Muk to the list, trying to use power of alchemy to shut down Jirachi players, and I think it might give us a good chance against some Zapdos builds. So I think there's actually something behind this deck, and much more than I originally thought. I thought the archetype was kind of just dying, but if there's more Zoroark coming into the meta, that's a good thing for clowns, and having this Muk can give you some out to these Zapdos players, so I thought it was worth visiting. So let's have a look at the list. First of all, for Blacephalon-GX, he has three great and versatile attacks. Bursting Burn can burn and confuse your opponent's active for one fire. Can be pretty nice when you face down against other GX stuff that's just basics. So if you see, I don't know, like an Ultra Necrozma straight up against you, or a Pikachu and Zekrom, you can go for early Bursting Burns and force them to retreat. We also have the Burst GX attack for just one fire. You can discard one of your prize cards. If it's an energy, attach it to one of your Pokemon. So you have the real high roll potential of getting extra energy acceleration. But in general, just take a prize card is good enough as how it reads. Mind Blown is the main attack though. You do 50 times the amount of fire energy to any of your Pokemon. You put them into the Lost Zone, however many you want, and you do 50 times. So for two fire, pretty efficient on itself. We have lots of Nagas in the deck to try and charge up, get as much use out of this as possible. Alongside Beast Ring, we can get into huge damage numbers with Mind Blown for big one-hit KOs, even up against some tag teams if we really need to, which is pretty awesome. From there, 4-4 of the Naganadel line. I still prefer to play the Poison Poipole, especially when there's so much Zoroark in the meta, and Zapdos. Poison doing 10 can save you an energy later down the line, so definitely play Poison Poipole. It's good against 110 hit point things, which there are lots of, and 210 hit point things, which there are lots of. So play this one over the one that looks at your prize cards for sure. Charging Up has a great ability. It allows us to attach energy from our discard pile to this Pokemon once per turn. So he provides like a free retreater in the deck. He provides extra energy acceleration towards Mind Blown. He also provides a great non-GX attacker and pivot when we are up against Zapdos players that use Escape Rope. If they use Escape Rope, we bring up a 130 hit point Naga. That's really awkward for them. They have to find double Electro Power to deal with us. So we're trying to negate the amount of use they can get out of their Jirachi. And, you know, if we're using Muk anyway, they might be forced into Escape Rope on certain terms, and then they can just fall very far behind, which is awesome. Turning Point does 80 for 3 colorless. And that means that with a Beast Energy, we can be knocking out Zapdos, which is also something definitely worth noting, because we will try to be as non-GX as possible in the matchup. Unfortunately, Jirachi does have resistance to our Nagas, otherwise this card would be amazing at dealing with Zapdos Jirachi. We do also have the 3 prize card turn, where we can do an additional 80 damage to go to 160. With the high roll of a Beast Energy, we can knock out GX Pokemon, and obviously you can knock out things that are weak to Psychic, but in general, this is just a good attack to use when we are on that 3 prize turn against other non-GX Pokemon. Again, Zapdos comes to mind because it's just so relevant right now in the format, so keep an eye out for your Turning Point turns. From there, we just have lots of one-offs. One Ditto Prism Star. It can evolve into Naga or Alolan Muk, so it's definitely huge in this deck. We're obviously using the Psychic Alolan Grimer because we play 4 copies of Mysterious Treasure, so we're going to give this good early game search ability. This can also poison on the coin flip as well, so if you happen to lead him, you can sometimes get the early damage on, which is worth noting. And Alolan Muk, obviously, in here for shutting down Jirachis from opposing, Zapdos and what's it called? Malamar players also play it, some Pikaroms play it, Jirachis everywhere. Power of Alchemy, huge ability right now in the game. And when you have so much search ability with 4 Ultra, 4 Treasure, this is actually a deck that can get the Muk out very early. Like, other than Zoro, this can get out the Muk, like, as quick as anything else, really. So that's pretty awesome. And we actually have the board space for it anyway. There's been previous builds of clowns that played the one Ditto, one Muk, and sticking in the Grimer doesn't feel too horrible. From there, we're going to have one Let Loose Marshadow for some good early game disruption, and also just extra draw on our end, and one copy of Tapu Lele for wonder tagging and guaranteeing supporters. Onto the item cards, we have had to make space for this Alolan Muk, so things have got a little cheeky. Normally, I would play 2 E-Switch, but we're limited to just one copy. It's still really nice for when we can go like all in with clowns sometimes, or if we miss Beast Rings, we can just go charging up manual attachment E-Switch to the active. So it's really like a get-out-of-jail-free kind of card when you've kind of whiffed on other things. The E-Switch can bail you out, which is nice. I think when you only have one copy, it's not often that you can like plan to like Cynthia and hope to hit an E-Switch, whereas when we play 2, you could try and go for that a bit more freely. So it is a little bit limited, but I still think it's worth playing the one copy just in those awkward spots. The other card I cut to fit in the Muk Grimer was the Ultra Space. It's a little awkward only playing 2 total copies of stadiums because we don't have many shrine removals. So you could think about adding in an extra Ultra Space again, but for now I'm just trying the Alolan Muk. I think that'll give us the highest win rate against Zapdos over anything else, even if they are trying to shrine to punishment you. So then we just have the four ofs of Beast Ring, obviously a huge card for this Ultra Beast base deck, trying to pull lots of fire energies out and making our mind blown do ridiculous numbers. Four treasure, four ultra, we want to have high outs for all of these psychic dudes, which is a big portion of our deck. The Heat Factory Prism Star, still an awesome stadium card, discard a fire from hand, draw three, obviously great supplementary draws for us whilst also powering up, charging up, which is awesome. Onto supporters, two copies of myself. It can discard two cards and draw four, which is pretty awesome. I think it, again, just has synergy with the fire stuff. I like having more supporters in total. There's been times where I've had four Cynthia, four Lillie, just three Guzma, and no other Sophocles. Like I had a second E-Switch or a second Ultra Space for a while. But we kind of bricked a little bit too much. And I think especially when you have a low end Muk, you shut off your own Lele and Marshadow. So I like having an extra supporter or two supporters in this list to try and safeguard from our own Alolan Muk ruining us. Three copies of Lillie, obviously it's huge early game, but gets a little weaker in the mid to late game. So we're going to have four copies of Cynthia as the gold standard of a supporter. Just shuffle draw six is safe and solid. And three Guzma as well to pick off some key targets from our opponent's side of the field. One Beast Energy, still bugged on PTCGO, but busted in real life for damage buffing our stuff. Great on the Naga for knocking out GXs or for knocking out Zapdos, another 110, was basically chunkier basic Pokemon. And good on Blacephalon as well for saving you an extra energy here and there, which is definitely worth noting. And then 15 fires to round out the deck. Other cards you could think about considering. I've already talked about how I would like to have higher counts of energy switch and multi-space. Ultra space, not multi-space, don't know what I'm talking about. But there are some other things we could be considering. And this is Viridian Forest is one stadium that I've thought about playing because again, it just has synergy with your nags and it can lower your hand size to improve Lillie as well. Acrobike is another card. It's been in other Blacephalon builds. You lower your support count, increase your Acrobike count and just cycle through the deck a little bit more, which is also definitely worth considering. And the final one for me that I would think about is Choice Band, especially with the amount of Zoroark here and there. One or two copies of Choice Band will improve your Zoro matchup. Sometimes you spend one less fire and it's all going to be chill. But many of the Zoroark builds have cut away from Weavile and many of them are not playing like Giratina to get around Beast Ring anyway. And if that's the case, we just Beast Ring our way to victory. That's pretty much the plan. So let's get some games in with the old clown. I think it's a pretty interesting deck. You also catch random Celebi Venusaur players trying to have a good matchup against Zoroark and Zapdos, which is also pretty fun. So catching these anti-meta players cold is pretty fun, whilst also having a very good Zoroark yourself. Blacephalon was one of the main, it was the best deck points-wise. In the Lost Thunder meta, and it's no secret that it had a pretty reasonable Zoroark matchup the entire time. Many people had to move to like ZDT to jump over Beast Rings, and Zoroark had to play like Giratina and all sorts of stuff to have a reasonable matchup. So I think farming some Zoros is no bad thing in this meta, especially because Ivanov's list cut Kukui and Devoured Field. They can't one-shot your clowns very easily. So trying to capitalize on Ivanov's popularized build and make them pay. Make them pay for their ignorance that Blacephalon is still a deck. We're still out here. We're still out here charging up, blowing their minds. We're doing it. We don't even care. Oh, Slugma. This is a control list. No, because it plays Weavile. Okay. This isn't Ivanov's list. What's going on here? They can knock out our stuff. Crumbs. Okay, we're playing units. Okay, chill, chill, chill. We'll just attach in Cynthia. Not a bad start from us, to be honest. Sophocles is going to be good next turn. And let's think about this. Do we want to burst GX? On turn two, he could just be knocking out our Poipole with a Bloodthirsty Eyes, Riotous Beating. If he does that, the 10 damage on the active doesn't make too much of a difference because we still can't reach. So it would be burst GX into Bursting Burn is probably what we're looking to do here. Just because we haven't got many Poipoles on the board. If we had more Poipoles, we could consider going like Bursting Burn and then hoping to get enough charging ups to take a knockout on two, but because that's not happening, we should burst this turn and Bursting Burn on the Zoroark next turn. Miss energy. Not surprising. You never expect to hit energy off burst. You just take a prize card away from yourself, accelerate towards the goal. And if they're gonna try and use a Weavile, we've already squared up our own prize trade, so this makes sense to me. If they're not going to Lycanroc and leave our Poipole, we still wouldn't be able to reach. So it's always correct to burst here rather than Bursting Burn. They're going to put the Zoroark in the back and trade. Gets rid of a Choice Band. We'd be kind of worried if they are playing a low in Ninetales with their unit energies. You'd imagine it's Lycanroc, but if it's a low in Tails, we're in trouble. DCE, Lele, probably just going to use my Poipole. They could bring up the other clown as well. I would just attach and Bursting Burn regardless. Oh, they're actually going to grab Judge. Interesting. This way they don't have guaranteed attack, though. This is really weird. Really bizarre. So they're just accepting that they can't attack us this turn? Really weird. Well, okay. We're gonna let loose him straight back. We get the benefit of evolving into Naga. It's more difficult for him to KO this. He needs to have Stadium as well. We draw into Energy and Lillie, which is nice. Could go for a Mind Blown here. Am I always attaching to the active? Let's think about this. I don't think I'm always attaching to the active. We still could even Guzma. We could KO Ditto this turn with a Mind Blown. That'd be pretty annoying for him, huh? Yeah, I like it. It's pretty efficient. It's only one energy that we have to toss. Get use out of our energy switch. The pro one of. Getting rid of a potential Lycanroc or Ninetales. Either of them would be awkward. And we keep a reasonable amount of energy burst potential for next turn. He goes into his Zoroark. And we're staring down a Rockruff that they've put in. See a trade. Gets rid of a Field Blower. The only issue with our sort of aggressive Ditto knockout is that we weren't able to develop more Poipole. We're hoping, though, that Beast Ring will be the hard carry. Which is never a bad thing to hope. We're pretty far ahead right now. even if we have a slow bursting burn turn this turn, I feel pretty reasonably far ahead. I don't mind benching this. It's not like I'm ever going to Lele. Beast energy isn't too shabby. I think we just energy to the back and bursting burn. We have no beast rings or draw power, but he doesn't know that. This is a scary turn for him, that's for sure. She doesn't know that. Let's see how they're going to respond to this. They may have to retreat into Lycanroc. Even that would be scary because I could... Like, it's so likely that my hand has B-strings, right? She has no idea that my hand is so weak. There's no way that she would know. Especially when I play so few cards, it's more likely that I have B-strings. Because I've, like, done nothing with my hand. It's the old bluff. That old chestnut. I'm going to trade an Ultra Ball. I'm going to grab Magcarigo. Do some smooth criminal activity. They are going to attach to the Rockruff and use Bloodthirsty Eyes. Or at least evolve. Yep. Oh, this gets so heavily punished by Beast Rings, it's just we don't have them. Nah. You would cross your heart and hope for Beast Rings play. Any discardable card is good as well. Or sorry, any card that does discard, so I could charge up and respond. Actually, I mean, we get an energy in the discard because this gets knocked out, right? Yeah, we're fine. We're fine. It's not great, though. We always want to use our beast rings. That beast. Yep, I'm just going to go in. Go in and swing. Dangerous Rogue. Ba-ba-da-ba. Well, at least we can draw cards. Actually happy with this outcome. Beast Ring Pog? Oh, no Beast Ring. This can't be Lele or anything. I might just treasure to get an extra card out of our deck, though. I already have a manual attachment for next turn. We played our energy switch. This is the problem. The problem here is that we've played an energy switch, and we only play one. So B-string is even more important in this list. Because he can just Guzma KO this with a Zoro, and then we're just like charging up and bursting burning. And how does he take his last two prizes? We have to make sure we don't put down too many Nagas for the Weavile to win, basically. Okay. I don't think there's ever a world where we don't take the knockout there. It might lead to some awkward turns, but we'll see. So they're always using Guzma here, unless they're ultimate greed, hoping that because we didn't B-string last turn, we won't this turn. But they're probably getting me off rings. How many choice mana have they played? one. That makes me putting a third Naga in, or sorry, a third ability into play very scary. Especially when they can smooth over. Basically means I can't, right? I just have to do one charging up, one attachment. They're gonna recover a Rockruff. And here comes Guzma. Oh, one more trade. And Beast Ring is deactivated. Offline. Picking up Ultra Ball is irrelevant. So we just bursting burn here. Can't put another Naga down because of Weavile. Now, if Beast Energy wasn't bugged, we'd have game next turn. But Beast Energy is bugged, you see. So I would be shaking their hand to win, but instead I'll do the Mind Blown and then do an Angry React and concede. But we'll know that we would have won if this was IRL. I think that's the best we can do. Not bad for a Blacephalon that didn't Beast Ring at all. Huh. Why would they retreat into another Zoroark? It means I don't need Guzma for win. Oh, okay. I guess that's why. Cool. Well, GG. Needed Beast Rings. That old chestnut. Let's get into another game. I think that was probably like the most difficult Zoroark we could face, to be honest. One that played Mag Cargo and still played all the Kikui banned devoured shenanigans. I mean, that's gonna have a terrible Pika ROM, but good against clowns. Let's get into another game. It wasn't even in my field of vision that they could hit 180, just because I've been looking at Stefan's list so much. Mid-game brick, rip. We're going first, so we'll hold the Grimer for now. If we see Lightning, we'll go for it. Alolan Muk actually protects our Naga quite nicely against Persimmon, so that's something worth noting. I'm going to toss one Beast Ring away, because they're normally going to try and spread around us. Ultra Space. We really need to have... answers to Shrine, so we'll attach, we'll bench. Don't think there's much point in us benching an Alolan Grimer just yet, because we have no draw in our hand, and this is only useful if it becomes a Muk, right? We don't want to give him free Flying Flip shenanigans or free Guzma targets. We'll just pass. Persimmon, huh? Simeon is an interesting matchup, for sure. Depends how they try and take it. Looks like he's going aggro monkey, this turn at least. Well, looks like he's mixing and matching. Just playing his hand down, maybe just for a Lillie. Yep. There's the shrine. Just a team play for 40. It's not too scary. Let's use the Ultra Space. Get ourselves Poipole number 2. Let Loose is unfortunately prized, and putting Lele onto the board is disgustingly bad. Ugh, gross. So we have the option to Mind Blown if we want to. What's our alternative? Just Burst GX. We could get knocked out next turn. 3, 6, 9, 10, 13 is in range with Band. So do I want to just knock out a monkey? The reason against is counter energies come online. Is Bursting Burn actually our correct move here? Makes him pay retreat, find energy. Has to be exactly DC instead of counter energy. Yeah, I think Bursting Burn's our move. It's pretty slow, but I think it's the move. We get punished for attaching to the active. Okay, let's do it like this. This is pretty slow, but I think it's correct with our hand being as slow as it is. Not the best, though. At least we're limiting our bench. They probably would have played more Ball Search if they had it in hand last turn for more damage, so there's that going for us. We can play Guzma. And just flying flip us. Yeah, okay. That's fine. Get out a nag. I think we just Guzma here and burst. Probably gonna have to Lele next turn. Oh, poggers. Okay, we'll put it on a nag. The dream. Counter energy is now available. They need monkey band to take a knockout. Not that they need to take a knockout. They have the benefit of time on their hands. If this takes another hit, we want it to stay active, because we don't want to be attacking with other stuff and then them to put Shrine into play and just be dealing with our dudes. Interesting counter catcher play. Okay. Picking up a fire energy is not bad. We continue to thin the deck a little bit. I think a Mind Blown isn't too bad. We don't really want to take knockouts of Turning Point because it can always just be answered by the Simians. We can Mind Blown this and just get rid of two energy cards. I think that's fine. We're holding off from Lele as long as possible. Prize number 2. More Pokemans. There's a Shrine. We need to try and bounce that ASAP. Kind of counterintuitive to put a Lele down when you see a Shrine, but we need to bounce it. So we can't do this slow approach for much longer. Let's see. We've Cynthia'd. I wonder what else they want to do this turn. Maybe it's just another flying flip. They might be debating monkey pressure. We haven't done much for a few turns, so you may be like, this hand might be dead. Could be a good time to try and pressurize with Persimmon. Now I'm going to rescue Stretcher. Do 70 with Persimmon. 80. So Shrine ticks over. Pretty cute math. Now we really need to find Stadium removal. I guess we're always tossing away the fire here. No, we're not, because we're not guaranteed to hit it off the Lele. Let's toss Ditto, because that's definitely a liability. I'm just going to attach active and guarantee the attachment. I think this is fine. I think these are necessary evils at this point in the game, which is a little bit ugly, but like I said, necessary evils. We held out for as long as we could. We do hit Stadium, which is unreal. So good that we got that. We can even draw more cards, discard more energy cards as well. This is all looking pretty gravy. I think we're not going to be using the muck here, so I'm just going to start Ultra Balling these things away. Help us get towards... do I sack the... Okay, keep thinning. We did a lot of deck thinning that turn. That felt pretty good. So we'll take two off the active, because if he's flying, flipping, or attacking with anything, like the only thing we're not protected around is Fling. And if he's using Fling, is that actually a problem for us? let me think about this. I guess we just stay safe. Bloody Fling. I don't want to get flung about. Could randomly mess us up somehow. Let Loose, not a bad pickup. Might be really helpful late on, because we haven't seen any engine from them at all. Haven't seen any Oranguru or Macargo at all. So a mid to late Let Loose when they have low amounts of energy remaining could be pretty good. They're going to DC Guzma. Okay, that's scary. Again, we have the one energy switch in deck, which is scary. Oh, nice. Hit it. Oh man, I wanna discard energy here pretty badly. It's gotta be too greedy, right? It's got to be too greedy. It's always too greedy. 5-6 outs in a 16 card deck. 6 outs in 16 card deck, drawing 3. I don't know if we need to take a risk here or not, if we're going to win. If I get rid of all 3 energy this turn, and next turn he keeps us off Beast Ring, we're just wrecked, right? Then he can flying flip his... No, he can't flying flip, I guess. The Beast Rings. Yeah, the Beast Ring carry could be fine. Okay. Let's not get too greedy. It's not all of our energies anyway, right? Okay, 5, 10, 15. I think this time it's this way around. Ugh, I'm so greedy. Okay. Full greed. Eight energies annihilated so far. None in our discard pile. Are they gonna trigger good old Beast Rang, or are they gonna do some Lele shenanigans to try and wreck us? I guess that's why we have to keep the energy on the active, just because of fairy or psychic Lele, psychic transfer shenanigans. I think in a game I may have taken that risk to draw more cards. We had 6 in 16, we were so unlikely to miss, and getting an extra energy in the discard, basically on the board, would have been so helpful. Especially if it was the beast energy, it would have been huge. I don't know if I missed a trick there. Should have gone greedy, I think, because we are pretty behind here. One bit of good news is the flying flips are still pretty slow for him. The shrine coming in is pretty awkward, though. Wait, why? Holy! Da-da-da-da! That's pretty dangerous, huh? Well, this is a first for me. To see that in action. Poggers. Okay. Let's reset our hand here. Certainly scary. What a sick turn from him. That's just rude. Charging up. Luckily, we still have our beast energy in deck. I don't think I let loose this turn, I think I let loose next turn, because I want to Sophocles. What a sick turn though. They're gonna put down Zebra and Nest Ball. They might be considering the proactive Lele. But they just go for another Coco. They're gonna Ultra Ball as well. Getting rid of so many Ball Search cards is good for me, I think, because it makes it less likely for him to get off Let Loose. Gonna put another Blitzel down. Wow. Double sprint is one way to not miss. They grab another DC as well. Lillie for 5. That electrical play was absolutely wrecked. The feels when wrecked. Okay. Ah, we hit beast energy. Perfect. I was going to have the yikes time of trying to Sophocles into it, but no problem. Do this, and we can just let loose. I mean, he still has a sprint. He needs to find counter energy, which he's been through two of. And any Ball Search card for Fairy Lele, basically, is what we're currently losing to. We still have a thingy in deck, right? Guzma. So it's worth pulling this out. Okay, let's see if he can Fairy Lele us for game, or Psychic Lele, or whichever one it is. They have Sprint available, and they have 5 cards. That doesn't have it raw, aren't they? Nest Ball, Counter Energy, GG, easy. Embarrassing. Okay. Okay. That was pretty disgusting. We've had 2 like close losses so far. Feels bad, man. Let's have one more game with this deck. Clowns. Clowns, clowns, clowns. We again had like mid-game brick. Him getting around the beast ring was dirty. So we've had one game where someone got around beast ring, and one game where we just whiffed rings. And both times we've been in touching distance of the game. Just got a little bit out of reach. I see Buzzwole. Do I imagine that Buzzwole is just in Zapdos builds? I guess that's the thing we gotta try and do, right? I don't think we can get Grime before Poipole, though. We have so many outs, so many more outs to Poipole. We have 3 and the Ultra Space. Let's go Greed. Maximize the Greed. So many more outs, boys. Play to the numbers. Attach, let loose. No, I can let loose next turn. Especially if he started Buzzwole. His hand might be terrible. And a let loose is so much better when we put double nag down. We could also save treasure for Muk turn 2. That would be jokes. Oh no, I can't Muk, because I wouldn't be able to let loose. That would have been a highlight reel in itself. Okay, it looks to be a Zapdos. Do they have knockout on Grimer turn 1? No, they have Volkner on turn 1. Excellent news. I'm going to grab Nest Ball Lightning. It's a real shame that we can't let loose and Muk. Getting rid of guaranteed Muk turn 2 is sad. It's just our hand doesn't go anywhere. If we top deck a good supporter, that's the dream. They're going to rope us. Rope is a little awkward. Don't really want to give him poipoles. These nags are so tanky and annoying. I guess we just go into the other clown. Try and rush ring. I mean, next turn we can just burst GX anyway. Make him move his own Zapdos again. There's a Guzma. They've already played the Volkner though, fortunately for us. So they're just gonna skateboard out of there and whack us for 80. Okay, what's the top deck? It's a clown. Okay, let's just double evolve and let loose. A real man would have top decked a fire energy and just attached and put the Muk in. Second chance with Cynthia. Nice. We nailed it. Let's see how we do with this Muk in play. Make life pretty awkward for him. Unfortunately, our hand is kind of stalled again. Would really hate to Sophocles away 2 beast rings. Do I ever go for Bursting Burn? We know they have Guzma in hand, so it's not like they're going to be trapped. No, we just burst GX here. And high roll of fire energy like a man. See? All right. Muk established on turn two. Double Naga on board. They have Guzma. Where are they going to try and put it? On our other Blacephalon? Maybe on the Marshadow? Oh, this isn't a Volcanoes, actually. Okay. Interesting. They're going to grab Switch Lightning. I actually kind of want them to have Electro Power, so we could just go nuts with our Beast Rings. They're going to develop another Zapdos. Pop the Lightning onto it as well. We obviously have the Switch available. Yep, nice gold Switch. Into Zapdos. No Electro Power, just going to smack us for another 80. So, we will toss the ring and the Guzma. It's not great, but energy is necessary in this spot. And we're just going to Mind Blown. Keep the energy on the active for any reason. If he doesn't take a knockout, we still have the energy to attach, and or we can still just attack. But if he is, you know, likely to take the knockout, we have Beast Ring anyway. And now we pick up a second one. This feels much better. Let's see if Muk has taken its toll. They still have Guzma available, remember? They're just gonna sledge Guzma on our other clown and sledgehammer. Yeah, this feels good for them. Oh, they can sledgehammer Muk. Very cool. Gets around Beast Ring too. Pretty nice. And by nice, I mean nasty. Pretty nasty. Well, picking up energy is good. I think we're just killing the Jirachi here. We've been living a little bit on the edge with this deck. He can obviously come in and just sledgehammer to finish us off, so that's not a concern for him. But his hand size is still pretty low, and now there's no Jirachi on the board. Muk, at the very least, did his job for the opening turns and made life difficult for him. What? Oh, wow. We got baited. That's pretty sick. I have Lillie too. They've been waiting this whole time for this moment. They've got Scoop Up Block. Sure. Why not? Why not? Sledgehammer us. It's our turning point turn, which is very good. There's also Beast Ring Town. Let's charge up the active. I think we just attach bench. Don't know if our Lele's in deck. Would be very good to know this information. This is our last Blacephalon anyway, though. So I don't think I want to Ultra Ball this turn, regardless. Unless it was these. Is Lele in deck? Great question. It's not like I've had searches for this way earlier on in the game. I mean, our turn is already solid. What else do I need to Lele into? Maybe I just hold this. Sure. Realistically, what would we be Lele-ing for? Just like more Beast Ring would be just about it. But I think it's going to be very hard for him to... Well, he could take us off Beast Ring just by killing this, I guess. Regardless, we pick up a Cynthia, like a champion. Maybe we should have dug more rings. I think we have enough damage, though, to take two individual prizes. Don't think that's our problem at this point in the game. It's whether they can knock out Marshadow and Blacephalon before we take two single prizes. The one thing that we are worried about this turn is a Tapu Koko GX coming down. That would be the big fear. If you do it with a Guzma as well, that would be nuts. But the thing is, he hasn't been using Stellar Wishing, so it's going to be so super hard to get Koko Prism, Koko GX, Guzma. If he gets it, fair play. He's had one Stellar Wish, so his hand must already just be the nuts. But next turn, we've got a mind-blown, like, loads of energy just to play around the Koko. They have Rope. Okay, Rope's not too scary. We have our other Nag just there ready to go. He would have to sink double Electro Power into it. They haven't played many though, to be fair. There's Koko Prism. Yikes. How far away were they? I guess that was another argument to the Lele. Could have Ultra Ball and Fire, put down the other Blacephalon, Lele. If we'd hit Beast Ring, he wouldn't have been able to put down Koko GX. They are going to Volkner now. That's not a Guzma. Happy days. So I'm going to grab Board and Lightning. Okay. Wonder why the escape board. Ultra Balling away choice band blower. So it looks like they were actually just Guzma away from winning. I say winning, like killing this is basically game. Because again, we only have the one E-switch. Which I keep saying is punishing, but we keep finding it anyway. Do a little dance. Bro. This is not correct. I just have game on board, man. Hello? Well, that was bad play from them. Yeah, that was a really weak play from them. But we did get to see the Muk in action, at least. And that starved him of a lot of Jirachi draws, which was pretty sick. We starved him of draws for, what, three turns? And that led us into the game. Let us get two Nags down, whereas previously they'd just be Guzmaring Poipoles for fun. So yeah, I think there was a little bit of brick factor going on. I think you can see the Muk does eat up some spaces, and that is awkward for sure, so... Still some work to be done with this list, but I do think it's interesting and worth toying around with because it's a nice answer to Zapdos, and you should, in theory, as long as you can hit Beast Rings, have a good Zoroark matchup. We obviously lost one today, but if you're facing Zoroark Lucario, you should have a way better time anyway, because they have way less one hit KO potential on 180 hit point GXs, and at the same time, we just bricked and missed Beast Rings. So if that doesn't happen, we're going to be in much better shape. I wish I had Heat Factoried against that Simeon player. That's the only thing that I wish I did differently, I think, in that game. But regardless, we got wrecked by an Electro Ball play, which is pretty sick from them. Yeah, interesting games. Clowns is still reasonable and definitely worth experimenting with. So let me know what you think about it, guys. And that'll be it for today. And I'll see you in another video soon. Cheers.